Hi friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. In this video, we will be analyzing the news of 11th of July. These are the topics we are going to discuss today. The first topic is about Section 377. Let's have a brief look into the timeline of the events that led to the constitutional bench hearing the case of LGBTs in India. So in 2009, NAS Foundation is an NGO working for the cause of AIDS affected people. So they filed a case in Delhi High Court, and the Delhi High Court gave a verdict that Section 377 of IPC is violative of liberty defined under Article 21 of Indian Constitution. So, opposing this decision, few activists petitioned to the Supreme Court in order to review the order given by Supreme Court in 2013. For that, a 5-member constitution bench was constituted in July. And this constitution bench has started started the procedure, and this constitutional bench has started the judicial procedure. During that judicial procedure, the judges have given certain opinions during the initial days of hearing, and this topic is pertaining to the opinions offered by the judges. The judges have opined that a person's choice of a partner is a fundamental right irrespective of the sex of the partner, and it can include same-sex partners also. They have taken the cue from Hardia case of 2018, in which Supreme Court has opined that neither the state nor one's parent can influence the adult's choice of partner. And Section 377 describes LGBT actions as unnatural, and it is against the order of nature. And all the Section 377 is a remnant of Victorian era in Indian judiciary. Section 377 is one of the residue of the Victorian legal system in India. And this definition of unnatural in IPC, the Section 377 has a term called unnatural. And the definition of this term unnatural is very obscure. Even sex between a man and a woman, apart from the conventional way, it also can be termed as unnatural. So now the Supreme Court has planned to take a wider approach. Apart from deciding the sexual orientations of people, it has decided to examine the wider concept of the term sexuality and to include the issues related with cohabitation. The next topic is pertaining to the simultaneous election being pitched in by our Prime Minister Narendra Modi. We all know that the Law Commission has released a draft white paper for introducing simultaneous elections in India by 2019, most possibly by 2019. So the Law Commission has favored for simultaneous elections, and the Law Commission has also mooted a consultative mechanism with the political parties. And during the consultative mechanism, 9 political parties have voiced against the simultaneous elections. So what are the advantages of simultaneous elections? The first advantage is reduction in election expenditure. Second is the government will be focusing, due to model code of conduct, the government's functionality is being curtailed. And now with the simultaneous election in the fore, the government can focus on legislation and governance. And as we all witnessing now, the country is facing a continuous number of elections. Last month, there was an election in Karnataka, and this would be followed by elections in Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan in future. So the country is continually in the election mode. This is hampering governance. So these are the advantages as stated by Law Commission. And one of the major disadvantages during the elections, elections to the Lok Sabha, the issues will be national. During the elections to state legislative assemblies, the issues will be regional. Now, the situation is such that national issues might overtake the regional issues during the time of simultaneous election, and the vice versa is also the true. The regional issues may overtake the national issues. This is a cause of concern. So now, if the government has proposed to have simultaneous election by 2019, consider this scenario. Now, the Karnataka government has recently been elected during last month. Now, if they are conducting election 2019, within 1 year, the term of the Karnataka Legislative Assembly will be curtailed, and this will pose a question of legal propriety. The Law Commission has also proposed that election would happen for one group of states in 2019 and for another group of states in 2024 in order to synchronize the state elections with the central elections. Apart from these, the Law Commission report has also mentioned few electoral reforms. What are they? The first is introduction of constructive vote of no confidence. Like, say, if an opposition party is moving a no confidence vote against the incumbent government and the opposition party succeeds in removing the government of the day from the power, then the opposition party, which has moved the no confidence motion, should give a suggestion how the course of the government should take forward. So, this is an important recommendation being given by Law Commission. We all know that Panchayat Raj elections should happen within 6 months, 6 months after the curtailment of existing incumbent members. And the term will be only the remaining term, not a new term. So, Law Commission has proposed to introduce the same principle for legislative and parliamentary elections. So, if a midterm election has to be held, the term of a house would only be for remainder of its tenure, not for a new 5-year term. And they are also mooting to introduce a one-time waiver for anti-defection law. The next article is on bilateral relationship between India and South Korea. President Moon of South Korea has been on an official visit to India. And yesterday, world's largest mobile factory was opened in India. So, apart from these commercial events, there are also certain bilateral issues that were discussed during the official visit of President Moon. The first one is security and peace. So, during the press conference, after the meeting, Prime Minister Modi said that there is a dangerous proliferation linkages between Northeast Asia and South Asia. This was nothing but a veiled attack on China and Pakistan. So based on this, Prime Minister Modi has claimed that India has an important role to play for peace in Korean Peninsula. The second aspect of the discussions were related to trade. India's bilateral trade with South Korea has decreased. Now it is standing at $20 billion. And the plans are being made increase it to $50 billion by 2030. And there is a huge trade deficit between India-South Korea trade activities. India has a negative trade balance with South Korea. The present value is around $12 billion. And India is working on to reduce the negative fallout of trade deficits. The South Korean entourage has raised concerns about ease of doing business in India. These are important concerns related with trade. Apart from these discussions, a vision document was released as a part of meeting. The vision document speak about military exchanges between India and South Korea in order to improve peace in the region, and also with training and experience sharing of military personnels. The leaders also spoke about research and development, including innovative technologies. And both the countries are aiming to create a peaceful, stable, secure, free, open, inclusive, and rules-based region. And this is in line with 3 P's recommended by President Moon. What are the 3 P's? The first one is people, second is prosperity, and the last is peace. Apart from these, India and South Korea have joined hands together in order to rebuild and reconstruct Afghanistan. So, India is now following the Act East policy, and South Korea has recently proposed this new Southern policy. These two policies should be on same line in order to create a peaceful, stable, secure, free, open, inclusive, and rules-based region. The next topic is related with US sanction on Iran and its possible implications on India-Iran relationship. US envoy to United Nations Ambassador Nikki Haley, during her recent visit to India, she had asked India to comply with the CARSA norms. We have made a elaborate discussion on CARSA in our video dated 5/7/2018. Please watch that for further clarification on CARSA. What was the request of Ambassador Nikki Haley? Ambassador Nikki Haley wanted India to cut down the oil import from Iran. So, now India has not taken any stance as far as the request is concerned, but Iran has given some hints to India what could be the stance of Iran if India is complying with US request. Iranian ambassador to India, in a recent public meeting in Delhi, he has said that if India is taking any stance, if India is cutting down oil imports from Iran and increasing its oil imports from Saudi Arabia, Russia and United States, Iran will move towards ending the special privileges offered for India. What were the special privileges? During the earlier economic sanctions between 2012 and 2015, Iran helped India by allowing rupee denominated imports. by which India was able to buy Iranian oil in rupees, not in US dollars. This is the aid which was mentioned by Iranian ambassador. He says that Iran will revert the rupee denominated imports to dollar denominated imports. This will have a significant impact on our current account deficit. As we discussed earlier, Ministry of External Affairs has also said that India will consider all stakeholders, discuss with all stakeholders before taking any decision. The Iranian ambassador also said that unilateralism by US has been imposing a heavy cost on world. Now that we all know the world trade is increasing after recession. After a few years after recession, the world trade was shrinking. Now it is slowly in a growth phase. During this particular time, restricting access to Iran or restricting, creating a phase of unilateralism is going to hamper the recovery of global trade order. So the ambassador also said that conflict in Gulf region would drive up the price of crude oil and it will impact growing powers like India and China. He has also raised a few concerns, pointed concerns about India's lack of accomplishment in Chabahar port project. The next topic is related with FSSAI's new initiative called Eat Right Movement. So this is mainly related with cutting down salt, cutting down sugar and cutting down oil. So this movement is built on two broad pillars. The first one is eating healthy and second one is eating safely. Through this movement, FSSAI aims to cut down salt, sugar and oil consumption by 30% in 3 years. And they have also roped in celebrities in order to publicize the initiative. The next topic is about the tourism potential of Western Ghats. A Lonely Planet, a website dedicated for travelers, it has rated Western Ghats as fourth best tourist destination in Asia. So they have called Western Ghats to be one of the hottest biodiversity hotspots of the world. It is well known that Western Ghats is also a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And most important point is Western Ghats has the endemic, the Neelakurinji flower, endemic to Western Ghats, blooms only once in 12 years. And now it has bloomed in Munnar. And they have given data about the species variety, species diversity and genetic diversity of Western Ghats. Western Ghats supports the life of 7,402 plant species, 1,814 non-flowering plants, 139 mammal species, 508 bird species, 179 amphibian species, 6,000 insects and 290 freshwater species. And they have given some data to indicate the species diversity of Western Ghats. Western Ghats supports the life of 7,400 flowering plants, 1,814 non-flowering plants, 139 mammal species, 508 bird species, 179 amphibian species, 6,000 insect species and 290 freshwater fish species. The next topic is about inclusion of 5 Schedule 8 languages in Rajya Sabha for simultaneous interpretation. The languages are Dogri, Kashmiri, Konkani, Santali and Sindhi have been included for simultaneous interpretation. Rajya Sabha had earlier initiated the simultaneous interpretation for 12 Schedule 8 languages. The languages are Assamese, Bengali, Gujarati, Hindi, Kannada, Malayalam, Marathi, Oriya, Punjabi, Tamil, Telugu and Urdu. Apart from this, other 5 languages, they are looking to implement simultaneous interpretation. Those 5 languages are Bodo, Maithili, Manipuri, Marathi and Nepali. So this is an important step towards improving federalism in country. Rajya Sabha being a federal house, it is important that the languages of country are being represented in Rajya Sabha. Thank you.